Hey, it's Tamara here. Welcome to another episode of my tutorial series about making a farm game in Unity, or as you may know it, making HayDay. In this episode we will develop one of the most important features in the game, goods production. Given what we already have in the game, developing this system will be super easy, and you're finally going to finish the storage manager system, so the player can keep track of the resources. To recap, in the previous episode we made a farming mechanic. The player can now place a field on the map, click on it to get a display of possible crops to use, plant and collect. The system utilizes C# interfaces to make it possible to reuse it for other purposes, which we'll do in this episode. By the way, subscribe to my channel and turn on the notifications to not miss out on the new episodes. I'm planning a few more interesting things for this project. Just a reminder that we're going to build upon what we already have, so if you haven't seen the previous episodes, go check them out. And if you just want to skip rewriting code, you can support me on Patreon and get the source code along with the project files. And now, let's get to the video. But before we do this, let me introduce you to the sponsor of this video, Machinations. If you're thinking about developing a simulation game like HayDay, an RPG, or basically any game that has some kind of economy going on, you should definitely check out Machinations. It is a platform that allows you to run simulations to determine the right parameters for your game, to keep the players interested at any point. This amazing platform allows you to simulate a variety of things like currency, enemy kills, health, experience, loot, etc. With the help of an interactive, easy-to-use interface, you can map your entire game and get statistics about the player's resources after hundreds of actions in the game. I've always struggled with figuring out things like reward amounts, item prices, experience to give. If I put too much, the game would be too hard. Too little, it'll be boring. I would play it multiple times to guess which number is right. But with Machinations, I can rely on science and simulate hundreds or even thousands of iterations for all my game mechanics. Just imagine having such a professional tool that's used by big studios. But even if you're a solo game dev on a budget, don't worry. The Machinations community plan is free if your revenue or funding is under $100,000. And they offer a free plan for all academic institutions. Follow the link in the description and start designing game economies like a pro. Let's look at how things work in the original game. There are a lot of different production buildings in the game. They work similarly to the fields, have the same items display, same item drag and collision system, and a timer, though they do have a few differences. For example, product slots and the timer is displayed in different way. In the system we're going to develop, we'll have all the same things. We'll modify the items tooltip that we had to have slots, and they'll have their own script to add new functionality. And finally, we're going to create a production building script that will be responsible for the whole production lifecycle. Open up your HayDay project. First, we need to do a few things. Create a prefab for a production building and a shop item for it, just like we always do. Create a script called production building in the folder sources. In addition, in the source UI folder, create a script called slots. That's all the new scripts we'll need for today, because we're mostly going to be working with existing ones. And speaking of slots, I modified the items tool to prefab and added these slots. They have their own parent object, a separate first slot, and a scroll view for the rest of the slots, including the add slot button. Slots themselves are just images. Also, you have to add colliders, both to slots and item holders. One of them should be a trigger, for example slots. Remember, item holders have a prefab, so just add a collider to it. In addition, create a new tag called slots and set it on the slots object. First, we're going to take care of the production UI. Open the UI drag script. Go to the fixed update function. In the if that checks for drag, write another if to check if the source type is not a production building, since they'll act differently. Paste all the code we had in the drag if into this new one. After this, create a bool called overslot. Create a method onTriggerEnter2D, which accepts a collider2D. Don't forget to actually write the 2D bit, because you can see that I forgot. Here, check if the other object has the tag slots. If yes, mark the bool overslot is true. Next, create the opposite method onTriggerExit2D and set the bool to false. scroll down and find the onAndDrag method. Write an if to check for slot overlap and call method onCollide, passing the source if it is true. Moving on to the next script, slots. I first created a static variable for instance, but you don't need it, as I realized later. Create a public placeable object color with a get and a private set and a private timer. Then write two serialized fields for the time left tags and a list of game objects for slots. Also, create a bool countdown. In the awake method, disable the game object. Again, we don't need the static instance. After this, create a void initialize slots with a template t. It accepts a list of objects called item q. The template t should be of type producible. In this method, create a for loop to initialize the slots. Make the condition that the index is less than the slots count and less than item's queue size. In it, get the icon image from the slot and set the sprite to the A1 from the queue. We'll also need a clear slots method. In it, set the time left text to empty and go through each slot and set the icons to null so they become blank. Now, create another template button that accepts a game object color and a list of type T for item's queue. Likewise, specify that the T is producible. In it, get the color first and then check if the queue is not null. If yes, clear all the slots and initialize them with the item's queue. Get the timer component from the color object. Set the countdown bool to true. In the else, just clear the slots. After the whole if, set the object to active. In the fixed update, check for the countdown, and if it is true, set the time left text to one you get from a timer. For this, call the method displayTime on the timer. One more thing for the script. Create an onDisable method and nullify the color and the timer, and set the bool countdown to false. Also, we have to edit the items tooltip script. Create a serialized field of type slots. Then create two more methods. First, a template method for showing the tooltip. We already have a method with the same name, but this one will accept a list of all items, not a dictionary, and an additional list for the items queue. Set up an index I and make a for each loop to go through all the items. In it, initialize item holders by getting the distributor component and calling an initialize method. Then increase the index and check if it doesn't go out of bounds of the item holders list. After this, calculate the position for the tooltip. You can just copy this code from the other method. Call showSlots on the slots. And finally, set the object visible. Then create another method called showTooltipStatic. It'll accept the same parameters and have the same template where T is producible. In it, simply call the method we created earlier on the static instance. We're done with the UI, so it's time to move on to the Storage Manager. Open the Storage Manager script. Scroll to the bottom and create a method called updateItems. It will accept a dictionary of collectible items and integers and a bool add. If it is true, it means that we're adding items, false, we're spending them. We have to go through each item pair from the items dictionary. Get the item from the item pair key and the amount from the value. Check if we're not adding and change the amount to a negative number. Now, check what type of item it is. If it is an animal product, then add the amount to the appropriate dictionaries. In this case, it will be animal produce and barn items. Now, write ifs for all the types of producible items. Another thing that we're gonna need is in the storage building script. In it, find the method onClick and call the initialize method on the storage UI. It'll ensure that every time the player opens the storage, the item's UI is updated. One small thing to do in the timer script. Correct the order of invocation of the timer finished event. It should be like this. First, set the seconds to 0. Second, invoke the event. I discovered that a different order caused a bug. Now that you have everything else set up, we can proceed to the main part, the development of the production building lifecycle. Go to the production building script. First, make an inherit from a building and add an interface isource. Implement the interface members right away. Next, write a serialized field and a list of producible items. They're going to be visible in the editor, so we can assign products to prefab. Then, write an integer for maximum slots. This can be increased when the player buys more slots. The next field is the product amount. It is set to 1 by default, but it can be doubled for special events, for example. After this, write a queue for producible called current queue. Remember, queue is a data structure with a first-in, first-out order. That's exactly what we need for this case, because we have a line of products to be produced. Also, create another one for produced goods. We'll also need a producible field for current prod and a timer for it. That's all for the fields. The first method we need is called startNextProduction. It will manage the queues for products. First, pick at one product from the current queue. We shouldn't take it out just yet because we still need to see it in the slots. Next, initialize the timer with the name, dateTimeNow, and the production time of the producible item. After this, add a listener to the timerFinished event. Inside it, change the state to ready. Dequeue from the current and add the current product to the produced. Then check if the count of the queue is more than 0 and call this method. It kinda looks like recursion, but not by definition because we're invoking an event instead of calling the method within itself. In else, destroy the timer and nullify it. Outside this block, start the timer. Also, normally in HayDay you'd see a UI icon indicator appear when an item is ready, when the timer is finished. But I've skipped it so we can focus on the overall lifecycle. Now let's get the other two methods to work. First, the method produce. Check if the queue size is more or equal to the maximum slots. If so, we have to return because the line is full. After this, check the item path to see if it is a producible item. In a for each loop, go through each item needed to check if we have enough of it. Remember, we wrote a method in Storage Manager for this. If it returns false, then the player doesn't have enough and we have to return. If we pass this block, charge the player the items needed using the method that we wrote earlier. It's called updateItems. Encode the products in the current queue. Check if the state was empty. If so, we need to start the production. If it is already going on, the previous method that we wrote will take care of it. First, set the state to in progress and add the timer. And then you can call the startNextProduction method. Afterward, don't forget to call the showItems tooltip because we need to update the UI immediately after an item is placed into a slot. Another method is for collecting items. First, create a dictionary with collectible items and ints for the result of production. Dequeue an item from the produced and add it to the dictionary. Get the amount from the production amount that we wrote at the beginning of the script. Pass the result and true because we're now adding items. Next, check if we still have items in the produced queue. If the count is 0, check the count in the current queue. If it is 0 as well, set the state to empty. Otherwise, change the state to in progress. Also, you have to go back to the building script and refactor the method on mouse up as button. Remember that we're doing everything through a virtual method onCollide. In the production building onClick, check if the building is built. I did it by implementing a bool build. Finally, it is time to connect everything and check if it works. First of all, create a scriptable object for our product. I set up some test values here. Then add a production building script to the prefab. Remember the one that we created in the beginning. Don't forget to set the size in it and add a product you created to the list of products for this building. Next, go to the items tooltip prefab. Add the slot script to the slots object. It should be on the parent object for all the slots and not the scroll view. Fill in the slots list on it and time left text. And then go to the items tooltip and fill in the slots field on it. Hit play and see what an amazing system we just developed. You can place a production building on the map. When you click on it, you get a tooltip with all the item options that you can drag onto the slots and start production. After the production is finished, you can click on the building and collect the produced item. Here you go, an item was collected and the new item is on its way. Looks like we're done for this episode. Thank you for watching. We have yet another cool mechanic in the game. And in the next episode, we're going to tackle saving. Hope you're excited, because it is an interesting system to develop. So subscribe to my channel and hit that like button if you enjoyed the video. And don't forget to check out my Discord server, where you can share your work and chat with me and other game devs. Also, I'd like to thank all my patrons for supporting me and welcome new members, especially Marcelo Enrique Senko, Daniel Ringer, Dave Collinson, Paven Kate Pally, Eritz Escondel, Ahmed Belmekfi, and Gurkamal. See you in the next video! Bye!